All right. Hello, everyone. Thank you all for coming to Brentwood-Darlington Neighborhood Association's friendly candidate debate. We are thrilled to provide this opportunity to meet our potential elected officials. I'm Chelsea Powers, Chair of the Brentwood-Darlington Neighborhood Association.
I'm Jennifer Young, I'm the Lens President.
Alright, before we begin, a few things. First of all, thank you to all of our awesome volunteers for making this event possible. Volunteers, can you like wave your hands during the round and about volunteering? They all have official name tags printed with our logo, so if you need something, just flag them down.
And we'd like to thank the Gathering Church for donating the use of their space and equipment. What a fabulous building this is, I must say. Thank you to New Seasons on Woodstock, Cuppletown Bagels, and Mee's Cakes for the main refreshments.
And we want to say thank you to Ashley Paul and Catherine Thomas from Signing Resources for providing our ASL interpretation. And thank you to Jessica Dover from Alma for providing our Spanish translation. If you need Spanish, make sure and let us know. She's got headset.
And as a reminder, the nearest restrooms are located behind you in the hallway.
Alright, now if you look at your programs, you'll see the schedule. The first two debates will be held in this room, but the informal meet and greet will be held upstairs for refreshments. And when our second debate segment concludes, please allow us to dismiss the candidates first before making our way there.
The five questions for this debate were sourced from multiple Southeast and East Portland neighborhood associations and community groups. It is important that all voices of Portland be heard, since two of the people here today will go on to make decisions on our behalf for the next 4 years. The candidates will have 90 seconds to answer each question. Thank you to our timekeeper, Graham Williams, from the Brentwood-Darlington Community Watch.
All right, now without further ado, let's meet our candidates for Portland City Council Position 2. Candidates, if you could come up. Go ahead and see Grant, we'll get you a microphone.
Yeah, that's fine, yeah.
It's important to provide access once you have access, I'm going to be able to make some significant changes. The reason why I'm running is because I moved here several years ago from New York. I lived in D.C., L.A., Seattle, and now I'm here in Portland. It's the first time I felt at home in any place. Just really fit in the city, the mountains, the water, the people, the food, the culture, and just the energy, the vibe of this city. It's spot on. One thing is that there's so many issues that I find every single day where I run into these issues every single day, and I feel like we just need to make some changes. I have passed a law now requiring captions to be accessible in all public places, in lobbies, in various establishments. So that's one thing that I have accomplished in my past. But I'm not satisfied. I want more. I'm hungry for more. I feel like it's time for me to not just be standing by, sitting on the other side. I want to be here in City Council. I want to make some changes. I'm the first deaf person to run, and I feel privileged to have this opportunity. I can talk a little more about that later, but I'll tell you my platform. I like to focus on houselessness, mental health services, transportation, and police reform as well. That's one of my top priorities and concerns. Accessibility is, of course, important. And I look at accessibility, if you're focusing on just one narrow, specialized portion of that, you'll miss out on everything else. Transportation, mental health, police reform. That's why, you know, accessibility is the foundation that will solve all these other issues. I'm not trying to put a band-aid fix on anything. I'll tell you more later. Thanks, guys.
Okay, we have a surrogate for the fish. He was unable to attend due to medical reasons.
Thank you. Obviously, I'm not Nick Fish. My name is Courtney Carter. I'm surrogating as Nick Fish's surrogate to take a weekend off to recover from his Friday cancer treatment. Nick's running for re-election to the Portland City Council on the record and working with the community to solve tough problems. He has experience in relationships, our community, and passion for public service to move our city forward. And he's working hard to ensure that each Portland will see his fair share of city services. That's why he's endorsed by Senator Jeff Merkley, former mayors Tom Potter, Bud Clark, Commissioner Amanda Fritz, Linda Robinson, and Arlene Murrow. Nick wishes he could be here today and ask him to thank the organizers for allowing him to serve in person. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next.
Hi, my name is Nicholas Sutton. I want to apologize ahead of time. I suffer somewhat from social anxiety, so it's a little stressful, so I've got a little script to keep myself on track. I spent the bulk of my actually, let's skip that. I've lived in Portland since 2005. At a time of working a minimum wage job, I could afford to find myself a single bedroom apartment and survive moderately well. Those days are gone. And as the cost of living continues to spiral out of control, so too the days where people like myself who live at the bottom will continue to be silent. I'm here to present a new vision for the city of Portland, when where wages are fair and employment is equitable, when the houseless and poor are treated as equal partners in a growing city, not as undesirables to be driven out by the rising cost of living and rounded up by police. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think we're all a little anxious up here, so don't worry about it. All right, are you guys ready for your questions? What we're going to do is we're going to ask the question once, and then each candidate will have 90 seconds to respond to it, and each candidate will get to start off a different question. So we're going to start going the other direction this way, and with question one, Nick, you're going to start with question two, Nick Fish's surrogate working will do it. Question three will be Philip. Question four will be Julia. And then question five will make you fight for it. All right, are you ready? Interpreters? All right, our first question, sourced from Southeast and East Portland neighborhoods. Please discuss the balance of City Council representation for Southeast and North Portland. Would you support changing the city's charter to to allow for district-based representation.
It's particularly walking around Northeast, Southeast, East and Southeast part of it. Certainly, roads have been ignored. When entire sections of the city are being ignored, it's clear that there's a problem which needs to be addressed. The responsibility of city government is to assess the city's needs and respond accordingly. I would absolutely support changes to the city charter to ensure that each section of the city is actually represented by people who are aware of the difficulties their communities face. To that end, where I'd like to, I would probably reach out to Julia, who has made this a central theme of her campaign, and has far more effort into it than I. I do not want to see that go to waste.
Thank you. Corky?
Thanks again for reading the statement from Nick Fish. I lived in Northeast Portland for 20 years, and my understanding of issues of concern to East Side residents. I now live in a rental apartment downtown and walk to work. In our current at-large council system, where you live is less important than what you stand for. For example, Commissioner Prince leads the Parks Bureau and lives in Southwest Portland, yet she and I have been champions for East Side Parks, investing over $50 million in new parks in East Portland. They include the Hazeltine Park Nature Patch. Likewise, Commissioner Salzman leads the Transportation Bureau and also lives in Southwest Portland. He's been targeting tens of millions of dollars in gas tax revenues and other resources to make East Portland streets and sidewalks safer. District representation has certain potential benefits, including the reducing cost of running for office and increasing diversity on the council. I think this is an idea well suited to a charter review commission in 2020.
Thank you.
Jumel here again, running for City Council number two, petition number two. And yes, I absolutely support a charter for more equality and equity. I 100% support that. I'm a person with a disability myself who is running for this position, City Council, and I've run into many barriers, the first of which is accessibility. I have no access. And so to address this issue, I believe that what equity means is that we need funding. For example, we need $10,000 per candidate to start off on an equal basis, not be able to accept any donations from the wealthy who already have an advantage, so that anyone from any economical standing can run. Having these inequities is oppressive, and I think also it's important to have transparency through competition. And I think the charter and that both would help solve a lot of issues that I have myself personally faced. I think honesty and dignity are very important. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Julia?
So again, my name is Julia DeBras, and my primary priority on this campaign is representation. It's the main reason why I'm running, because I think it's way past time that the people city, especially those who live in North, Northeast, and Southeast Portland, were adequately represented. This idea that folks from the West Side are going to do a good job of representing us just does not pan out. My grandparents lived in the Montevilla neighborhood. I rode my bike around on these unpaved roads when I was a kid. That was kind of fun. I thought it was off-roading, but I'm 36 years old, and those same roads still aren't paved. We still don't have sidewalks. The neighborhood I live in is the neighborhood my grandparents lived in, and it's surprisingly unchanged. That's a long time to give this form of government an opportunity to serve us, and it has failed to do so. We absolutely deserve representation. I trust someone from Southeast Portland to represent Southeast Portland. We don't have to count on somebody from the other side of the river to represent us. And I really want to have a community-wide discussion to decide what it is that we want to see from the district form of government, so we end up with something that really, truly works for Portlanders. And I want to make it really clear that I stand with the people of the city, which is why I'm not accepting any corporate or developer money on this campaign. I want to make it clear to everyone here that I stand for you and the people who live in this city, and I want to center communities and decision-making processes, and you can do that so much easier if you have actual representation of city council districts on council. Thank you.
Thank you, Julian. So question number two.
If elected, how do you seek input from neighborhood associations and other community groups informing the work you do? What will you do to include neighborhood associations in the initial conversations about plans that affect their neighborhood?
And this time we'll be starting with Corky and Fisher Circuit.
I believe we make better decisions when everyone's at the table. That's why I support the neighborhood association movement and that push to give neighborhood business districts a stronger voice as well. Moving forward, we can strengthen neighborhood associations by making sure even more people participate. That's why I support efforts to bring more renters and people of color into the conversation. As City Council liaison with Portland, I push for the Catalytic Investment Initiative designed to support business associations in East and North Portland. This relatively modest financial investment by the city is providing extra capacity to historically underserved business districts with a focus on engagement and diversity. I also supported the creation of the East Portland Action Plan and permanent ongoing funding. EPAP is addressing historical disparities in city spending by helping set the priorities and budgets of all city bureaus. Finally, I've been a leader in reforming the city's boards and commissions. I push for more training, standardized bylaws, and mandatory disclosure of conflicts of interest. The goal is to encourage more people to participate and to magnify their impact.
Thank you, Philip.
All right, yeah, this is Philip. So I'll just keep it simple. I think the simple solution is to have the City Council host meetings, not just downtown, but go to the Southeast areas, go to Northwest, go to Northeast, and hold maybe 4 times a month or 10 times a month meetings there, forums there on Wednesdays and Thursdays. You know, figure out a schedule. But it's important to go to the various communities, gather the community members there, and ask for feedback. You know, and before anything is passed, before any motions are made, we get feedback from community members themselves. And then we propose, bring back to the community, and then ask for a vote. I think that would allow those community members to feel more involved and will have their voices heard, you know. And also help people who don't have access to transportation and who can't make it to our downtown meetings to be able to access it in their local neighborhoods. So I think that would be a solution to many of the issues that we face now, and it will also be a much more inclusive approach.
Thank you, Philip. Julie?
All right, I'm going to actually try to speak slower this time. My apologies earlier. This is a really important aspect of representation. If we actually had city council districts where we elected city council members who represented their constituents, that would mean that the neighborhood associations would be able to have a lot more power in that system in reporting directly to their representative. And it also means that the city would be able to provide a lot more resources to the community organizations so that there are stronger rules of participation and representation, right? We have a lot of neighborhood associations that aren't super representative of their entire neighborhoods, right? Not everyone who lives in those neighborhoods are being adequately represented within those bodies. Well, I think if we had an actual representative form of government and people felt that their voices mattered, were going to be listened to, and that there was real power in the neighborhood association, then there would be a lot more folks that would engage, and we'd be able to put a lot more resources into giving neighborhood associations the resources that they need to be viable and to have well-facilitated meetings and actual representative governing bodies within themselves, right? So again, this is an expansion of my vision of having a truly representative form of government for our city that elevates the voices of neighborhood associations, community organizations, and small businesses, you name it, all of the groups of folks in the city right now that are underrepresented. If we have an actual city council district system, will have our power. Thank you.
Thank you, Julian. All right, go ahead, Nicholas.
Okay, there are about 95 different neighborhoods in the city of Portland. I think it would be foolish for anyone to actually ignore the book of these groups and organizations around the city. Before pushing forward with any plans of making major changes to any neighborhood, I would like to give every neighborhood a say in anything that's going to directly affect them.
realize sometimes people's vision, representative's vision, and the neighborhood may not see eye to eye, and that's why I want to make sure there's an open line of communication, because it is my job to sell people on any idea I want to push. So I big on communication, I big on people reaching out to me, speaking to me directly. I love it, it's wonderful. And I will continue to do so where I love to. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicholas. All right, question number three. Our neighbors are concerned about crime and livability, including theft, drug dealing, and garbage and litter, and the rising cost of housing. What are your one or two top investment priorities for addressing these challenges? Additionally, would you support increased police staffing to increase patrolling? And Philip is starting this question off.
All right, this is Philip again. And, can you actually repeat the question again? I think it was a four-part question, right?
Yes, I'll read
the city.
Our neighbors are concerned about crime and livability, including theft, drug dealing, and garbage and litter, and the rising cost of housing.
Okay, thank you. So yes, there is a four-part question, right? So after an answer, best I can each one of those parts. For police staffing, I do not support increasing that, because Mayor Ted Wheeler in the past found a gun. And blamed a homeless person, saying that we need more police to staff neighborhoods to improve safety. So I went to several of his presentations, but now his message has changed. Now he's saying that we need 100 police because 911 calls are increasing, we don't have enough police staffed here, and we're paying a lot out for overtime. So, once Trump was voted in, we noticed various protests happening around the country. Police have shown up militarized with various weapons, throwing, using weapons that they should not have. Then people who have been arrested and later have had their charges dropped. And there's just been a lot of drama around this. And it's cost the city $11 million. And so if he wants $10 million for more officers, I don't think this is going to solve the problem. I don't think that's going to solve this issue. So I think we need more social services. We need to increase budgets for that, not to focus on the police force. They're not going to fix the problem. That's not their job. Their job is actually to protect and serve. It's not to do what they've been doing, which is just putting in its location. As far as thinking of our neighborhoods, I think that people who are out of work, they can help us with that. If we put those resources on them, they can start to earn money. Well, I'm also the interpreter to clarify. People who don't have work, why don't we pass on that responsibility to them? And can we add a little more time for the interpretation, please?
Yes, go ahead.
And I think that's a great way to utilize some resources in that way. As far as crime goes, crime's on the uprise. There's been quite a number of police killings recently because there's no accountability in the police department. So I think crime, as it relates to drugs, I don't think it's necessarily the crimes they're doing, but it's a mental health and health issue. You know, we can't just put people in jail. I mean, they're going to come back out into the world, and they're going to, it's not therapeutic, it's not going to rehab them. And so I think we should focus on that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Philip. We'll go ahead and give the candidates a few extra seconds as well. I know this is a pretty hefty question, so go ahead, Julia.
It's definitely a hefty question. So, the increasing crime that we're seeing is a symptom of poverty, right? We need to treat this as the public health issue that it is. People need services, people need affordable housing. We need to increase tenants' rights in the city so that people are less likely to get evicted. We need to end no preservations, entirely new location was a huge step in the right direction. We need to do more to overturn the state's rules so that we can actually get some rent control and our stabilization going in our city. But in addition to stabilizing people in our housing, we need to provide more services to those who really need that. We need more mental health services and drug addiction services. And that's a really great place to put the money that would be going into hiring all these new police officers, right? I would much rather see more investment in our communities than hiring additional police officers. That said, you know, I've met with the Brooklyn Police Association and they told me loud and clear they feel understaffed. And what I can say to that is a majority of the 911 calls do not require an armed police officer to respond to them. A lot of them could be better served by mental health first responders and unarmed first responders. You could also have unarmed police officers who are unarmed public safety folks who are walking the beat, who don't have a gun, which means they actually get paid less, right? They're much more affordable to hire those folks, and they would actually be in our communities walking the beat and maybe actually making people feel more safe because they're not walking around with a gun. So after the DOJ findings, after the most recent audit from the city auditor with the gang, regarding the gang task force, it's really apparent that if we throw more armed police officers into this culture that we have in our police of frankly targeting and not using good de-escalation tactics with those with mental illness and with our African American communities and other people of color, I don't trust the Brooklyn police as they are to solve our problems with 93 more police officers. We have to do a lot. Oh, I'm so sorry, I did not see the time. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, it's Nicholas.
Okay, I'm going to be echoing a lot of the previous sentiments here. Police are all too often seen as a solution to a problem when, in reality, they're an unfortunate necessity brought about as a result of failures in the system. More police are not the solution. They're only going to take money away from programs which could be bettering our communities. In making wages the central focus of my campaign, I will be directly addressing the central issue here, which is poverty. I would also like to push for, and this may not be a popular opinion, the radical decriminalization of all drugs across the board, because drugs aren't a criminal issue, they're a medical issue, and the city needs to be focusing on funding programs to help drug addicts, not mounting them up and throwing them in jail. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicholas.
In Portland, we're proud of our quality of life, but we're also experiencing growing pains. To keep up, we need to invest in affordable homes and return to a model of community policing. I've been a champion for affordable housing citywide. I pushed for record funding with the Joint Office of Homeless Services. I worked to pass the city's new housing law. I lobbied the legislature for authority to implement inclusionary zoning, and I proudly supported historic renter protections proposed by Commissioner Udalia. But we need to do more in East Portland, like strengthen our partnerships with Habitat for Humanity, building affordable homes in your schools, and providing the services people need to address addiction and mental health crisis. As part of the ongoing work of reforming our police bureau, we also need to invest in community policing. That means more cops walking the beat and building relationships with residents and business owners in the community. As we enter a tough budget cycle, I will not support cuts to parks programs that families, children, and seniors depend on to fund old officers. But I would support new revenues to increase staffing and strengthen community policing.
Thank you
very much.
Question number four. What will be your approach to balancing city expenses and revenue so that public facilities and services can be sustained?
So yes, I've been participating in this budget process, especially since the mayor called for 5% across the board cuts, and they put almost immediately community centers on the chopping block. And this isn't the first time that's happened. And I came prepared to give testimony at the first budget forum to talk about the fact that process is really messed up, right? They do this often, where there's a budget shortfall, and they immediately talk about how we're going to cut community centers and pits communities against each other. nice crumbs that City Council is going to hand out to us. And then at the end of the day, they end up not shutting down these community centers. But what a terrible process. Why would you do that to us, right? We need to be serious when we talk about solving our budget shortfalls and prioritizing our resources better. And the best they can do is put things like our parks and our community centers on the chopping block. That really doesn't sound like they're earnestly trying to solve this problem. I do think during this boom time, it is the perfect time to raise revenue on those who are making money on this boom. You know, the rest of the average worker is not seeing the benefits of this economic, like everyone making money, the developers making lots of money, and the large corporations are making lots of money in this region. We can have a much more progressive CEO tax to build on what Steve Novick has already passed. We can have our progressive taxes on the wealthy.
All right, go ahead, Nicholas.
Governments are also often bloated and full of unnecessary programs and expenditures. I'm a really big efficiency nerd because efficiency means less work, right? I think we all like to do a lot less work. I would like to put that dedicated mind to work to find more innovative innovation methods of achieving the same ends at less cost to the city. I would like to come over corporate incentives and determine which programs are actually generating positive results and which we can cut down. I'm also a huge fan of going to the people of the city and asking them if they'd like to fund an upcoming program where we have budget shortfalls. Taxes which only affect large businesses, so it's few are not off the table. This entire thing is a huge undertaking, and I'm willing to dedicate my every waking hour to making sure we can use our budget as efficiently.
First, I'll listen to the community and our budget forums. We do our best work in partnership with the community. Next, I do not support cuts to parks programs that families, children, and seniors depend upon. Parks programs enhance our quality of life and make our community safer. For example, my office has been working with neighborhood leaders to save the community garden at Darrell Heights Park. When I was the Parks Commissioner, we focused on expanding the community garden program. Now I understand that this garden may be at risk in order to bring long-promised sidewalks and road improvements. This shouldn't be an either-or conversation. Trading one community asset for another, we can have both. My approach to the budget is simple. We need to look at the cost of all our basic services, including community centers and parks, and then ensure we have the revenues to fund them. We cannot keep asking people to support housing and parks bonds and then turn around and cut popular programs. My priorities for this budget cycle are to invest in affordable homes and homeless services, protect programs that serve families and older adults, make our streets and sidewalks safer, especially in East Portland, and continue to stabilize utility rates.
Thank you very much.
All right,
we have one more question after Phil has been asking.
Hi, Phil, here. So there are several ideas that I'd like to bounce off you guys. I just met with the Budget Advising Committee. I was actually invited to represent the Portland Commission on Disability. I've been a representative there for 4 years, the same term now. Anyways, I went there and to the Budgeting Council. And, you know, I tried to fight, do not cut 5% across the board. Especially, you know, while you're designing a budget, you need to the budget for accommodations, that is so important. That will affect things down the line. And so we have to keep that. We cannot adjust that to 5%. We have to leave it alone. And the mayor listened, heard me. And I felt optimistic about it. Later, I spoke with the mayor, I think about 2 months ago, just one-on-one, and gave him some ideas on how to solve the issues that we're facing. And I was thinking, from each bureau, we can, of which there are total 8, we can cut 1% from each of those. 1% tax from each of those per year, and use that to fund our accommodation budget. And also, we can use that to increase the minimum wage. Because what how it is now is not enough. We need to tax the wealthy, which is not, and another one which is not often discussed, some churches. I know that I'm in a church, I'm very much aware, but that's kind of my style, is to call it as it is. Churches, we're talking about, if they want to talk about politics, then we need to involve them and tax them, and donate that money to people who are experiencing houselessness, to charities, etc., and mental health services. And that way we can start to bridge the gap. And also rent control. Landlords are both picking.
Okay. Before we go on, I wanted to make a note about the special accommodations. The interpretation here today is made possible by a special accommodations fund that neighborhood associations can build the city to provide services like this. So those funds are very important. All right, are we ready for question five? Okay, so let's go ahead.
Thank you, Chloe.
And start with, you know what? I'll start with Julia. Since she mentioned sidewalks earlier, question is, how do you plan on delivering on the long-ignored promises of pavement and sidewalks for the miles of unimproved streets in Southeast and East Portland?
So yeah, I think that this is a combination of prioritizing existing resources differently. I really truly believe that if we had a representative form of government for the last few decades that East Portland has been annexed into the city, that we would have seen those services. A lot of promises were made when neighborhoods were forced to annex into the city as they needed to get on the sewer system. That, you know, don't worry, you know, you're going to get all the benefits of being part of the city. And a lot of those benefits never came. And I think that getting actual representation in City Hall from folks who live in these neighborhoods is going to lead to reprioritization of existing resources to finally deliver these long overdue investments. We are, this is something that the city needs to commit to be doing, and I think that if we have actual representation, it'll create a huge significant change in the investments that are happening here. In addition to that, I mentioned this in my previous answer, I started to mention this, we should be increasing revenue during this boom time. This is the one time when it's actually really feasible to do that. We need corporations to be paying their fair share. You can also look at what's been happening up in Seattle. They have a linkage fee, which is basically a fee for large out-of-state contractors or businesses to open up shop in the city. They also pay for the services and the road maintenance and all the things that come along with the development, right? So linkage fees, increasing taxation on the wealthiest among us, and having much more progressive CEO tax rates than we'd be looking to.
Okay, we're gonna come back up the line and have Phil go next.
Can you repeat the question, please?
How do you plan on delivering on the long ignored promises of pavement and sidewalks for the miles of unimproved streets in Southeast and East Portland?
Thank you for reading the question. So that's very important. I use public transportation daily, and I'm not ashamed of that. I'm proud of it. I use the MAX, the bus system every day. I use it to get here today. And I do 3 forms per day almost, so I use it. And it's timely, but just like in a dollar view, I use public transportation. I'm here, I'm chatting with you, and you know, you're my voters, and so it's very important that I am able to attend these events. With that said, you know, the issue of pavement, potholes, we need to not just focus on, you know, $500 million on freeway expansion, we need to focus some of those funds to our communities to bring, you know, cars out of downtown where it's already choked, it's already packed in downtown. There's only $500 million. Why not put it within the city itself to improve roads? You know, so that we can encourage people to use the MAX, use the bus, which has been long overlooked. And we don't want to continue to ignore this. It's not right, it's unacceptable. So that's my solution, to refocus those funds.
Thank you. Corky, with me a fish.
First, I did want to thank everybody, all of you and fellow candidates for allowing to serve for me a fish. It's very kind of you. I also want to thank you for some great interpretive services. The city does need to get better, providing high quality interpretation services easily. too long, Portland, East Portland was ignored. This has changed. Because of persistent community leadership, EPAP and a council that is listening and acting, we're making real progress in making streets and sidewalks safer in East Portland. Using gas tax revenues, PPOT revenues, and state funding, we're investing in safety improvements in high crash intersections along Powell Boulevard. Guided by Vision Zero, the council just voted to reduce the speed limit on residential streets to 20 miles per hour, and on Star Street to 30 miles per hour. And we're continuing to press ODOT to transfer ownership of forfeit highways like 82nd Avenue and Powell Boulevard to the city. Finally, BES and PBOC are working together to coordinate investments in street upgrades, stretching the tax off. Moving forward, I will continue to insist that East Portland receives its fair share of city services. Thank you.
Thank you. Nicholas?
It is promises long overdue. And I come before we can move on to other major projects in the city, which are directly related to housing, helping the houseless. We need to stop everything and make this an infrastructure priority. I'm tired of stumbling around in the dark, nearly tripping on every sidewalk I walk down. I'm walking in the street, and I'm living this here. I know what it feels like to have a voice that is continuously ignored. And as your representative, I'll do everything in my power to make sure that voice is no longer ignored. Because it is my job to amplify the voices of people in my community so they will no longer be ignored. Thank you.
All right,
thank
you, candidates. You have been so great at staying on time that we have enough time for each of you to do a 2-minute conclusion. So we'll go ahead and choose, let's do Phil first for our 2 minutes. And Phil, we're going to give you 2.5.
All right, this is Phil G. Wolf again, running for City Council, Position 2. I'm proud to be the first deaf candidate in 104 years since the council has been established. So I'm very proud and humbled to be here with you guys. Thank you. Once I'm elected into office, I will really explain my vision for Portland and how I'm going to do this while also being a deaf individual. As I mentioned, accessibility is first and foremost the most important. I'll have 4 staff interpreters that will be paid by the city. We'll have 2 in the morning who will accompany to meetings in the mornings. The other 2 will be doing clerical work, office work, and other things that I need to run my office. So they'll switch off their duties throughout the days. And on weekends, I'll be hiring my own personal interpreter. And I will use my own funds from this position to support that interpreter. And all of my meetings and anything that goes will be accessible. All of my team will be able to sign. So that I have 100% access. But saying that, even though I'm a deaf person, I will do my job. I will fight for you. I will fight for this city. And I have led several protests last year. I've been a victim of police brutality. I am not afraid. I mean, the most heard. That's my personality. You know, I don't just stand up here and say big words to try and convince you. I'm a very blunt and straightforward person. If you look at my website, www.philipforportland2018.com, you can read more about my objectives, my goals, my background, some of my more recent accomplishments, and you can see more information about me on my website as well as Facebook page, Philip Wolf, with an E at the end. And that Facebook page, there's a campaign page as well as a personal page. I do not agree with separating that. I don't want to look to be one person on my campaign page and then actually be a different person in my real life. So I have this all on one platform. I have nothing to hide. So thank you so much. Look me up.
Thank you, Philip. We'll go ahead and let's switch it off and we'll do Nicholas Sutton next. We're going to have a lightning round.
Okay. Actually, I'm really prepared for this.
We like to keep you on your toes a little bit.
You know, I'm really excited by this entire process. I love that I'm actually, my voice is actually being amplified and out there, and I appreciate everybody who showed up here today to listen to my message. If I'm elected, I will do everything that I can to fight for those whose voices, like my own, are never heard in the city. If anybody wants to reach out to me, you can find me at my Facebook page at Nicholas Sutton for Portland City Council. And I look forward to hearing from you.
And just so you all know, links to each of their Facebook pages are on the description of this event for ease. And let's see, let's go get Corky with Nick Fish next, and then Julia, you'll be last.
Thanks to all of you for coming. This is what makes the city work. We really appreciate your participation and your tough questions. I don't have anything prepared for this from Nick, so I'm a little hesitant, but in a way it's kind of easy because one of the things I really like about Nick is that he does listen very well, and in addition to that, he responds. So go to his website, nickfishforportland.com, ask some questions, or better yet, email your questions to me too, and I'll be here afterwards. My email address is corkycollier@yahoo.com. Email me your questions, and I'll make sure that Nick answers them and responds to you well, because that's what he does very, very well. Again, thanks to all of you for coming, thanks for allowing me to be a surrogate.
Thank you. And Julia, you'll finish us out.
All right. Thanks all of you again for coming out. And I want to start by saying I wish I could stay all the way to the end of the meet and greet because that's one of my favorite things to do. But I was told today there's a participatory budgeting forum happening right now that I need to rush off to because that's one of my priorities as well. I think people need to be able to participate in the budget process and it's really my small. That said, I want to say that I am proud to have the endorsement of Bill Bradbury, the former Secretary of State here in Oregon, and of Bill McKibben, who is the co-founder of 350.org, as well as the endorsement of the Portland Community College faculty and staff unions and many others. You can see all the folks who are supporting me on my website, www.julia4pdx.com, and I also have that Facebook page. It's clear that I'm here to fight for the people, and I have a track record having grown up my entire life here in the Portland metro area and spending my entire career fighting on behalf of people against corporate interests and winning. Most recently, I led the 9-year fight to stop a messy water bottling facility from being built in the Columbia River Gorge where they wanted to bottle our public state water. And that fight took 9 years, but we ultimately won. I didn't give up, and I organized a really broad coalition to make that happen and kept it together for that full 9 years. I will bring that same kind of tenacity and hardworking ethic to the city hall when I'm elected, and I hope that you will do me the honor of voting for me on May 15th. And I also have handouts here. If you're interested, I might pass them out. And again, I apologize, I can't stay for the questions, but I'm always available. I encourage you to send your emails to me, and I'll respond to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, candidates. Okay, now we're going to take a short intermission and let our candidates for position two leave, and we'll get reset for the candidates for position three. So we'll be back in a little bit.
Safety issues right now, and yeah, I'm openly all for funding more police staffing. I think think this is absolutely a critical issue. I also think that emergency preparedness is a critical issue, and housing. But we're going to have to come up with more funding sources for housing. So that's why I'm running for city council, because we need to balance compassion with common sense.
Thank you. And Joanne?
Good morning. I'm Joanne Hartsey, and I'm also running for public city council position 3. I think we are at a time in our city where what we need is fearless leadership. I believe that we should invest resources where they are desperately needed. So for example, in Gilfig, please be placed mental health professionals being available for people in mental health crisis. Police will never solve our houseless problem, so what we need to do is actually get people into permanent, affordable housing. In addition, transportation is one of our biggest issues. I live in a community with no roads and big potholes and bad public transportation. If we're going to be a world-class city, we need a world-class public transportation system. I am a fearless leader who has proven over and over and over again that I get results. So if you want someone that's not going to give you platitudes, if you want someone who's going to get the job done, I should be your candidate for Portland City Council. And I want to remind you that I am the only candidate on this stage who actually looked Dan Salzman in the eye and said, I will run against you. It only took them 2.5 weeks to retire. Have a good day.
My name is Loretta Smith, and I'm running for Portland City Council, and I'm currently on the Multnomah County Commission. I'm running because I've been effective, and we've been effective in helping the most vulnerable in our community. And I know that talking to people and meeting them where they're at in their community is the most important thing, and that's what we've done a lot of. When we found out that the Cully neighborhood wanted to do something with their old dump site and make that out of a park, I thought that was very exciting. So that gave me an opportunity to direct some resources to that project from the county, from a public health standpoint. And that public health standpoint was, there was a physical fitness desert, rocks in the Cully neighborhood. Since I live east of 82nd, there is no one on the city council right now that lives east of 82nd, and there is no person of color to represent a voice for those who are voiceless. So I think I am the best person. I do have a track record. I've passed all kinds of budget amendments that would help the most vulnerable in our community since I've been on the board, and many of you saw me fighting that fight the other day about Wapato. Man, I'm still trying to get over it. But I haven't given up yet. You're going to get someone who has been in the fight for a long time. I worked for Senator White for 21 years since college, and I'm going to continue to fight as a city commissioner like I have as a county commissioner, and I would love to have your vote and your support.
Thank you. Andrea?
Good morning or good afternoon, everyone. My name is Andrea Ferrama, and I am running for Portland City Council position 3. And I'm running because everywhere I see a new Portland. And those of us who have been here even just a few years ago remember a Portland that was different, and even longer can remember something different. So with this new Portland, we need a new perspective, someone who's willing and eager to take on the new challenges that this new Portland is bringing. Four of those challenges that I'm really eager to hit the ground running to address as our next city commissioner include housing and homelessness, transportation infrastructure, jobs, and community safety and livability. I currently serve on the David Douglas School Board in Outer East Portland, and I'm the only one in this race who has actually had direct experience working in City Hall in the City of Portland as a senior policy advisor for the past 6 years. And so when we look at who we want to really address this new Portland, what is the vision that we have to make sure that we're looking at Portland's future, I ask that you see that I'm your candidate and that you vote for me. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Stuart?
I'm Stuart Evans, and I'm running for Portland City Council because our city needs a housing and planning expert to get us beyond our homelessness and affordable housing crisis. I'm an architect, planner, and innovator. For the last 20 years, I've worked with community groups, including Lentz, on housing issues. There are solutions for people experiencing homelessness. there are solutions for affordable housing for working families. We need someone with a successful track record delivering housing, and I am that candidate.
Thank you, Stuart. All right, we're going to get going with our questions. As a reminder, please speak slowly for our interpreters, and you will have about 90 seconds to answer each question, and Grant will hold up a stop sign when your time is up. All right, first question, we're going to go back down the line, starting with Stuart. Please discuss the balance of City Council representation for Southeast and North Portland. Would you support changing the city's charter to allow for district-based representation?
Yes, I would. I absolutely would support representation, district representation on City Council. It's the right thing to do. We're a much bigger city now, and our city council is kind of set up for a much smaller city. I also believe people on City Council need to have experience and have been in the communities in Southeast, North, Northeast Portland, as well as the West Side. And I have been, through my planning work and my building projects, I have done projects all over the city. I've done three projects in Lentz. I've done projects out in even outside of Portland in Rockwood, but also up in the Northeast, in St. John's, just throughout Portland. And I have been with all my projects have been community projects where I do community outreach and meet with communities, and I listen. So it's really important to have City Council members who listen to the community and work well with the neighborhood groups.
Thank you, Andrea.
Yes, absolutely. I think not only in Southeast or North Portland we need better representation, but in Outer East Portland and Southwest Portland, we need to make sure that we have across the board leadership who understands what representation means. And while it's true that we do have a process in place with a charter review in the next couple of years, part of the problem that I've seen in City Hall, having been there for so long, is that leadership too often hides behind processes. When leadership wants to get something done, they act right away. And so this is something that I would prioritize, or really one of the first things I would hit the ground running as your next city commissioner on, and voting me in office would actually create a majority on council to be able to do this. I think the second piece of this question is to not only really look at our new districting model, but to really look at the commission form of government that we currently have, and look at a way to create an opportunity for a city manager. Even with districts, the commission form would still be a problem, and so we need to have someone who understands the infrastructure of the city and how to make sure that we have leadership who understands how to address both. And then the last thing that I'll say is that this absolutely requires coalition building. This is a very key part of making sure that the voters make sure that this is something that is successful. And so these are, again, already conversations I'm having with key organizations, key individuals, to make sure that this is not just a city-led opportunity, but that this is a community-led vision. Thank you.
Thank you. Loretta?
Yes, leadership is important. I would certainly support and lead the charge on changing to single-member districts, because what you do is you give people an opportunity to have a voice for their communities. As a county commissioner right now, I am a District 2 county commissioner, which is inner northeast Portland, St. John's, and everything east of I-5 all the way out to 202nd. And where this came into play was, there was this big announcement that Nike made that said they were going to repave all the football fields for all the Portland public schools. And that the schools who actually raised the most money would actually get their football fields, turf fields, done early. And I thought to myself, Madison out there on 82nd, they're not going to raise as much money as any of those schools over on the west side. So let me figure out some way to kind of help them. And then I thought about Jefferson. Multnomah County pays for some high schools, that's Jefferson and Madison. So I went and talked to my colleagues, the city, Portland City Council, heard the same announcement I heard. My colleagues heard the same announcement I heard, but no one tried to come up with an idea to help those high schools. I put $50,000 in an amendment to give both of those high schools an opportunity, because actually 80% of those students are on free and reduced lunch. And I can make that case because we are a public health authority and we need to help those schools. And guess what? Madison got one of the first fields. Thank you.
Thank you. Joanne? I can read it again if you'd like. Please discuss the balance of city council representation for Southeast and North Portland. Would you support changing the city's charter to allow for district-based representation?
I absolutely would support district representation. I absolutely believe the charter review process is the right way to do it because it is a two-year process. It gives every corner of the city of Portland an opportunity to weigh in. If done right, every community will have the opportunity to discuss how do you want to be governed? What should governance look like, right? It is not, should not be left to some key people to decide how we are governed. It should be part of the whole community conversation, which is why access is one of my number one issues for my campaign. There's absolutely no reason why city council meetings happen at 9:30 a.m. on Tuesday mornings downtown. There's no reason why we, the public, have to sit and listen to certified smart people talk for 2 hours before we get out 2 or 3 minutes of public testimony. It should happen in the evening. It should happen in East Portland. It should happen in North Portland. And major public policy decisions should not happen in isolation of the people most impacted by those decisions. So as a leader, as someone who actually goes to the community that I say I represent, my job is to make sure that any corner of the city of Portland's voice is heard and that downtown isn't prioritized over people who are living in other parts of the city. I have found out the 91 house parties that the further away from City Hall you are, the less likely you feel your voice is heard.
Thank you. Alicia?
So just a quick show of hands. My name is Vigilante. How many of you guys are neighborhood volunteers? Right. How many of you have ever contacted City Hall to try to get a problem solved? It was fun, wasn't it? The commission form of government is broken. It's broken. It does not work. We are the only city in the country that still uses this model. It does not work. We need to switch to geographic representation. It needs to be district-based. It needs to be based on population. This has to happen. I'm a historian by training. One of the things that I learned looking at social movements in Portland is that you can get change, but it has to be people on the outside pushing for it, as well as having somebody inside championing it. The only way that this system is fixed is if all of us work together and force a charter change. This has to happen, and this has to happen now. So yes, I absolutely support changing the form of government and getting district representation. This has to happen.
Thank you. Andrea, you'll be first up to answer our next question.
Okay, question number two. If elected, how do you see input from neighborhood associations and other community groups informing the work that you do? What will you do to include neighborhood associations in the initial conversations about plans that affect the neighborhood?
So my overall philosophy on public involvement is that the city of Portland is a public entity and that engagement, particularly with neighborhood associations, is something that shouldn't just happen at city council meetings, but should happen beforehand when programs, processes, policies and projects are being developed along the way. This is something that I will continue to be committed to as a city commissioner. And an example of this commitment was the work that I did in the Portland Bureau of Transportation with the Foster Streetscape Plan. I made sure that they were very much committed to looking at business input, culturally specific organizations, and the Neighborhood Association was a key partner of mine in making that happen. And that's the type of involvement that I know we need to have. We need to be more thoughtful about how we are engaging with neighborhood associations, with people in the community throughout the process of implementing these projects in our communities. And then we need to go back to communities and report on it. What has changed? Is it been positive? What are the next steps? These are the things that I'm very much thinking of. I'm very proud that after this work that I did with PCOT, they implemented a full public involvement department, which hadn't been in the Bureau before, which was pretty interesting considering how how big that bureau is, but when we talk about this is a key part of it.
Thank you. Loretta?
Yes. Leadership should be transparent. Leadership should be inclusive. As a county commissioner, I learned about the Foster Powell neighborhood. They were going to get a homeless shelter put in their neighborhood, and they were told 2 weeks before that they were going to site it. And I was like, what? Well, this plan was already hatched up by our executive chairwoman, and she had known about it for months and gave the neighborhood 2 weeks at Christmas time to let them know that we were going to put a new homeless shelter there. See, that's not the way you do business as an elected official. If you know you have an idea about something, you have to bring the stakeholders in the beginning. You have to get their input so that you know some of the challenges and some of the successes that might happen with that. Needless to say, our boardroom was just bombarded with all kinds of residents. They were upset and they were angry, and they had every right to be angry. We took a vote to make sure that this litter would not happen, and it happened. I was the lone vote again that voted against it because I knew that the community had not been contacted, the business community, the neighborhood community had not been contacted, and so that's not the way you do business. As a city council woman, I will bring you in the beginning and be transparent.
Thank you. Joanne?
I can read your input. If elected, how do you see input from neighborhood associations and other community groups informing the work you do? What will you do to include neighborhood associations in the initial conversations about plans that affect their neighborhood?
Thank you. Neighborhood associations are a vital component of engaging the community on an ongoing basis, as are business associations, as are organizations that were formed. Like, I've been a part of the East Portland Action Plan for the last 8 years. We are not an official quote-unquote neighborhood association, but we are neighbors and business owners and community members who came together to advocate for our own best interests, because we knew East Portland was being left out of funding decisions. We weren't getting our fair share. We had so many broken promises from City Hall that we organized as a community. It wasn't until Sam Adams was mayor that there was even an acknowledgement that there was inequity in the resources that we got in East Portland. And so he started funding East Portland Action Plan for that effort. Now, I didn't need a title or a position to actually show up in my neighborhood and get busy and start advocating for the changes that I wanted. But with the title of City Council member, I will have much more ability to influence my other City Council colleagues to understand that you don't just come in East Portland during election time, but you actually spend some quality time in East Portland throughout the year so that you are engaging community members where they are. I think one of the biggest challenges with neighborhood associations has been engaging people who aren't homeowners, like renters.
Thank you much. Felicia?
So, full disclosure, I am a neighborhood association president. Back in 2011, my very first term as neighborhood association president, we had requested a loo in our neighborhood because we knew that people were urinating and defecating all along the parks. So we're like, okay, we want a loo. We want to do something about this. So the Water Bureau and Parks Bureau came to us, and we took them on a walking tour and said, okay, well, here are some different sites that would work really well, except this one block. Because this one block has a daycare. And so the kids from the daycare play in this park. So just not this one spot. Yes, where they live in blue. Now the daycare people have to go out every single day before they allow the toddlers to go play in the park and sweep for needles. That's not reasonable. We knew this was going to happen. Same thing that when Mayor Hill decided it was a good idea to suspend the camping ordinance. At that point, I was the neighborhood coalition president. We met with Josh Albert, Mayor Hill's chief of staff, and told him, Josh, this is a bad idea. Follow this through to its logical conclusion. We're still suffering from that. Neighborhood associations are great because they have the on-the-ground knowledge to say, will this idea work? Will it not? How can we tweak it to make it work more effectively? I will absolutely continue to listen to neighborhood associations. They are designed to be partners in city bureaus, and they're valuable partners, or at least we try to be.
Thank you, Stuart.
I went to the infamous Foster Cal Shelter meeting, and I was in the back row, and I was thinking to myself, so when is somebody going to ask the question? And sure enough, the third question in was, have you made this deal, have you made the deal certain, or are you going to be open for community input? And so the county chair got up and took the question, and she said, we have made the deal. We have signed the papers. And there was just this uproar that you could hear probably three blocks away. There were 300 people who couldn't get in. The trust went out the windows. It was just the wrong way. Of course, as Loretta said, that they had been thinking about this for probably months beforehand. Let's go back to 2013. I was working with NEA looking for a site for their second project the Generations Project. We just had an idea to put it near the MAX station in Lent. So I went to the neighborhood meeting and said, we're thinking about this site. And the neighborhood group said, no, we wanted to build some multifamily, higher density housing here. But we've got an idea of another site, the Foster School site. Why don't we meet you there on Saturday? So I went out and we looked around. And the point is that we got in at the ground floor with that project. We listened to the community, and eventually that project did happen on the Foster School site.
Okay. Ready for a third question? This one, Loretta will be going first. Our neighbors are concerned about crime and livability, including theft, drug dealing, and garbage and litter, and the rising cost of housing. What are your one or two top investment priorities for addressing these challenges? Would you support increased police staffing to increase patrolling?
I think elected officials should build a climate where business and people can have great paying jobs. I think investing in making sure that companies come into neighborhoods that they don't ordinarily come into is something to invest in as a city official. And the second piece is to invest in housing. I think we need to build housing at all housing levels in every neighborhood to make sure that folks at the top don't gobble everything down the bottom. One of the other issues that I learned was there are 989 brownfield sites. A couple of nights ago, we had a forum at the Delta House on Ainsworth in Albina, and that was an old gas station. They cleaned that property up and put a new facility on it, and it is great. It is a great space for the community. It's a great space for people to use. That's what we need to do in some of the neighborhoods that have not had resources put into them. Put some dollars to make sure the property owners, the people in neighborhoods like this one, will be able to upgrade their facilities to afford affordable housing, mixed-use housing complexes, so that folks in that neighborhood, one, will be able to get jobs, two, will be able to have affordable housing. Secondly, first thing we need to do is get some training for the police, for mental health, diversity, cultural diversity training, and sensitivity, because that is so important. Last week probably wouldn't have happened had it not been for the lack of training. And yes, we're a big city today. We have big city things going on, and we need more police in this community. We need to make sure that public safety is number one.
Thank you. Jillian?
I find it ironic that a California investor knew about a low-income housing project with 82 units before anyone in the Portland Housing Bureau had any idea that this housing was on the market and for sale. Maybe the city of Portland ought to hire this California investor to help us find low-income housing in Portland. Just kidding. don't quote that. The reality is that we should use our public safety resources wisely. So as an example, when you see firefighters running up the steps, in most people's mind, that says help is on its way. We have firefighters in every community in the city of Portland. 80% of the calls they answer now are healthcare related calls. Why aren't we asking firefighters to be first responders with people with mental health issues, rather than asking people who look like they're armed for war to go in and intervene when somebody is suffering a mental health crisis? We have to have common sense leadership that won't just go with the political win. Police won't solve our housing crisis. They won't solve the lack of affordable mental health services. And we have to use our resources wisely. We have public safety dollars. Let's invest them in the places that we know when they show up, people don't have a threat of death because of just over-aggressive action. We have already spent tens of billions of dollars since the settlement agreement with the Department of Justice on training police and de-escalation on people with mental health issues. It's not working. Lots of money and lots of training, it still hasn't worked. Let's get police out of the mental health business. Let's hire hospice people to clean up the trash in our community. Let's understand that but for grace, all of us could be hospice one day.
Thank you. Felicia?
This is a two-part question. So, priorities. So, I'm going to spend 1 minute talking about public safety, the second minute talking about housing, because those are my two priorities. So, first and foremost, raise your hand if you've ever called 911. Okay? Raise your hand if you've had to wait on hold. Not good. How long did it take before the cops showed up?
They never did.
They never did. Right now, what we have is when you call 911, you have to wait. Then, depending on the priority of your call, you might not get a police response. It could be anywhere from 6 minutes to an hour and a half. Right now, the core function of the police force is to respond to calls. Because of the staffing levels of the police force, that means all of the detectives who are supposed to be solving crimes are doing patrol. This means that all of the people who are part of the behavioral health unit who are supposed to respond to people in crises are doing patrol. This means that the people who are supposed to be the neighborhood response team officers who are coming out to do problem solving with neighborhoods are on patrol. Current shortage of police staffing puts all of us at risk. So on the second part, housing. We need more housing. We also need to come up with a way to pay for it. So this is where it gets a little tricky. We need to come up with a non-property tax measure in order to fund it. There's one model that's been used internationally. It's called the Urban Wealth Fund. They developed it in Copenhagen when they redid our harbor. Maintaining public ownership of land, allowed to be privately developed, take the money, pour it back into core infrastructure, like housing and transportation. This worked well in Copenhagen, so well that they completely revitalized all the transportation infrastructure. Then they put it in Hamburg, Germany. Worked like gangbusters in Hamburg, Germany. Last month at the World Economic Forum in Davos, the top economists in the world said the Urban Wealth Fund model could be the solution for paying for all sorts of infrastructure improvement in Latin America. We can do this here, so we should do this here.
Thank you. Stuart, you're next.
So number one, we need to end homelessness. I did a plan that I issued 3 weeks ago. It's on my website, stuartimageportal.com. I would love to get your input on it. All tents and tarps out of our city in 2 years, 75% of our homeless in tiny houses, micro houses, single room occupancies in 4 years. We have to do this. This neighborhood, I've been around many times and I see the homeless, and I've been on Springwater Carter and I've talked to people who shot up in front of me, and the sweeps just push people into neighborhoods, and it's just not right. We have got to get our hands around this, this crisis. Police. I voted this week. People were asked, do you support increases in the police force? I said yes. We've got to get more police on the ground. I did ride-alongs with police in this neighborhood, looking at some of my projects, and it was clear that the response times were delayed because of not enough police available to make responses to your 911 calls. So. We absolutely need more training for our police. With mental health, there needs to be more expertise on the ground. And we need need more police from the community who look like our community.
Thank you. Andrea?
So we know that here in the city of Portland, crime is on the rise. Violent crimes like homicide, gang violence, hate crimes. And so with that additional rise in crime, we need to make sure that we have a response that's thoughtful, that's comprehensive, and that's not the case right now. Currently, we know that when our officers are responding, they are overtired, overworked, and we know that when that happens, biases are more likely to be part of the decision-making process. And so we need to make sure that we are thinking about how to make sure that the resources that we put into the Bureau are effective, that our officers have a good night's rest before they're able to respond to this emergency situation time and time again each night. And in terms of housing investments, I think that that's absolutely another key part of the priority of budgeting for the work that I'll be doing as your next city commissioner. We have to be thoughtful not only about tenant protections, but also homeownership subsidies, making sure that we're providing opportunities for people to not only be creative in their current housing stock, but also make sure that we are looking at floodplain insurance, where that's very much a real cost in supporting families that way. Certainly, you know, I am a fan of making sure that we do have more capacity in the Bureau, leaning towards supporting additional officers, but not sure if 93 is the right number. I'm also not sure if the trade-offs are worth it in terms of the transportation infrastructure that we need, in terms of the housing infrastructure that we need. And I do wonder about what type of response we would have if we are expecting people to take ambulances and use fire officials, given that not everyone can afford that cost. I know the first experience that I ever had with an officer was someone who believed the domestic violence that we were experiencing, provided us the services that we need to get out of that, and also made sure that we had a long-term stability after, and I think that's what we need.
Thank you. Question number four. What will be your approach to balancing city expenses and revenue so that public facilities and services can be sustained? Starting with Joanna.
I think that's really a fundamental question. Today we spend 54% of our general fund dollars on policing, and community members still don't feel safe. That's the money that is supposed to be invested in our vision on where we're headed as a community. The general fund is the only flexible dollars that the city council has. So it's really important that those dollars are spent wisely. And I will prioritize this, making sure that we're investing in the transportation infrastructure where we have not made those investments in the past. It's absolutely critical if we're going to get people to living wage jobs that they are going to be able to get there. It is critical that we create new opportunities for living wage employment opportunities, which is why I'm the only candidate that actually worked to develop the Portland Clean Energy measure that will be on the November ballot that will provide a pool of resources, around $30 million new dollars that will be investing in climate mitigation and energy improvements, prioritizing employing those who have been left out of the economic engine. There are a lot of people making a lot of money in the city of Portland, but we're not investing in our infrastructure or the young people and people who need an employment opportunity. And so I'm the only candidate that had the foresight to know that we needed new money and we needed to invest it wisely.
Thank you. Felicia?
So my name is Felicia Williams, and I come from a very, very, very large family. So I've got 9 brothers and 5 sisters, and one of my brothers lives in Brazil. And so occasionally we bring up nieces and nephews to come visit us. And a couple years ago, my nephew Caio, who lives in Brazil, came to visit, and he was talking about government. He's very interested in this. And so I asked him, what's the role of government? What does government do? It was an interesting conversation. There are 4 things that government does. Protect the people. Identify problems and opportunities. Prioritize problems and opportunities. Fund them. That's the role of government. How many of you guys have had the dubious pleasure of serving on a city stakeholder advisory committee? city budgets? Anybody in here? I know Courtney has. Okay, I've served on the Bureau of Transportation's Budget Advisory Committee. I've served on the ONI, Office of Neighborhood Development Budget Advisory Committee, and I follow the Parks budget very closely. What I know is that we need to be on a two-year budget cycle, because right now we don't do any prioritizing at all at the city level. Instead, we do 5% cuts every year, and then at the end of the year, all of the windfalls that come back in, if there's additional revenue, just gets doled out to pet projects. That's political patronage. That has to stop. This requires a charter change. So this is another one that I'm going to ask you guys for. A charter change to put us on a two-year budget cycle so we can actually stabilize the city's core functions. Because if we don't do that, we stay in this limbo. And we can't keep doing this over and over again. That's the definition of insanity.
Thank you. Stuart?
So since 2012, I've been on a lot of school bond groups. I was one of the leaders of the latest school bonds. The first thing I want to do is figure out a way to reopen Marshall High School. You guys need a neighborhood school, and it needs to be reopened. As far as the city budget goes, I am the best of both worlds. I'm from the private sector, and yet I have done a lot of projects with the bureaus for my whole career with the city of Portland and other government groups. I have seen so many inefficiencies, and I've come up with ways to streamline. I want to go into budgets and look at ways and look at overlaps and ways to get the most bang for our buck with our public dollars. I want to bring in experts from the private sector to look at ways to streamline our dollars and get the most value out of our public dollars. We can do a lot better, and I've been working with the city for years, and I've seen what we can do to make it better.
Thank you. Andre?
So one of my frustrations with this question around balancing of expenses and revenue is that there hasn't been this approach to really looking at long-term planning in our budgeting, and specifically when we have conversations around operations and maintenance, that often is one of the first pieces to get cut when we're looking at our budgeting process. And so that's been the case with many shelters that we've seen out in East Portland. That's been the case with lots of transportation infrastructure and parks. And so for the plan that I have is to make sure that we're not only looking at where can we first prioritize, where can we first put these additional services, but where can we make sure that we are being thoughtful about the long-term operations and maintenance of those so that we have a long-term new service for the community. To me, I think another key part of this budgeting process is that we can't continue to ask neighbor associations and key organizations to make cuts every year. That's really unacceptable. We have to be thoughtful about how we're engaging. We need to be more strategic about public involvement, in my personal opinion. And then the last piece of this balancing of expenses and revenue is making sure that we are creative about additional revenue. So I was very excited to have been a part of the CEO tax. I'm really interested in looking at how we can expand that and make sure that we have the right taxing opportunity there or additional revenue. I also am really looking at a more progressive transportation resources as well.
Thank you. Loretta?
Thank you. Leadership needs experience, education, and track record. I am the only candidate who has experience managing a multi-trillion dollar budget on the federal level. I did that for 10 years with Senator Wyden. For the last 8 years, I've managed our $1.8 billion budget and passed it and looked at the budget and identified priorities for different communities in the city. And that's what you need when you look at who you want to be your next city council person. Who is going to look out for your needs out here? I will be the only city council person who lives east of 82nd, who's going to be looking at how do we widen our sidewalks and our streets and put resources into programs that will help the residents create jobs. I have put a lot of my political capital into supporting people who wanted to open up businesses. I created an inclusive fund that really supported women and people of color. Women have the lowest rate of getting startup dollars.
knowing that data, that compelled me to go talk to Mayor Hales to say, let's partner and put together an inclusive fund to help entrepreneurs in our city to get that first start. And that's what we've done. If you want someone who has a track record, that's me, Loretta Smith.
Thank you. All right, we're going to run just a little past our noon hour, but I know everybody would like to hear what we have to say, so we'll do our last question, and then we'll do the same courtesy as the prior group got of giving them each 2 minutes to conclude. So we'll start now with Felicia, question number 5. How do you plan on delivering on the long-ignored promises of pavement and sidewalks for the miles of unimproved streets in Southeast and East Portland?
This one's actually easy. Again, it gets back to what are the 4 functions of government? Connect to people, identify problems and opportunities, prioritize them, fund them. The money is there. It's called system development charges. All we have to do, $4 million from the Bureau of Transportation system development charges, $4 million from the Bureau of Environmental Services system development charges, those are the water sewer people, put them together, $16 million 2 years. That's all it takes. That's it. Every street and sidewalk in Portland would be paved. That's all it takes. It's not a priority. It's easy. And if I'm elected on city council, I'll do it. Because it's that easy. It just needs political will and somebody who wants to make it a priority. And I'm willing to do that.
Thank you. Susan.
In 2005, I was hired by the Portland Development Commission to do a scheme on a new Copper County site. And I did, and here we are in 2018, and finally something is happening. PDC had these, 14 acres of undeveloped land, and schemes that didn't happen, and grocery stores that didn't happen, and their emphasis was elsewhere. 3 years before I did the project for South Waterfront on the west side. Oh boy, everybody, all hands on deck, there was all this emphasis of PDC, you know, all this investment and so on. Those two projects flag that we are not prioritizing East Portland nearly enough. And when I get on the council, I will absolutely prioritize East Portland because East Portland is key to the future of Portland. I want to see as much emphasis in areas like this, in the southeast, outer southeast areas, east of 82nd. That includes great transit options, includes making projects happen that benefit the neighborhoods as is happening in other areas of the city.
Thank you, Andrea. So I live in the Gateway area and right off of 102nd. And I am worried about how often I can bring my daughter with me to walk in our neighborhood. We don't have sidewalks, we have really poor lighting, and there's this bright yellow sign right around the corner that says unpaved road ahead. And so this is a problem, right? When we have communities who are living like this, and we need to be much more intentional about bringing that infrastructure and those safety improvements. I think when we're living in Portland where it is unsafe to walk, it's unacceptable. So we have to be committed to making sure that we're looking at all individuals, all users of the transportation network, not just folks in their cars, but people who are walking, people who are biking, the whole city of Portland. One thing that I'm very proud to have worked on is bringing just this type of infrastructure into our East Portland with 122nd improvements. We partnered with TriMet to make sure that we were getting sidewalks, lighting, everything necessary so that TriMet could then go back and increase frequency of the service of the buses, which was incredibly helpful, something that we heard over and over from the community. And because of this advocacy, I heard it loud and clear, and I made sure that it was something that was delivered to them. This is the same type of commitment that I'll continue to utilize in this transportation conversation. It's very important to me, again, as someone who lives out there, and I do wonder about making sure that we have this additional advocate on city council.
Thank you. Loretta? As a single mother, I had to figure out how do I get my son to daycare, get to work on time, and make sure that I'm being responsible to our environment. I think we need to have a first-class transportation system. We need to improve on our transportation system because currently there is no way that single mothers or young fathers, that they can actually, if they work downtown Portland, they live out in the east, that they can get to where they need to in time to make sure that they're meeting all their obligations. So I know that it's so important to look at this. So I break the city off into quadrants. I look at the city streets and see where all the different sidewalks needed repairs and see where it was most needed. And I bet you, I can tell you off the top of my head that this quadrant would probably need a whole lot more resources and infrastructure than the west side. We need to make sure that we prioritize this. I can't say to you enough how important it was and how great it was to talk with Verde, who said, look, Commissioner, we need your help and your support with Cully Park. Cully Park is a city function, but I used resources from the county to help build those trails and those sidewalks around the park to allow folks to have an opportunity to have a good space to walk in.
Thank you. Joanne? As someone who lives in Gateway, I see every day the lack of investment in the transportation system in East Portland. And I have the history of knowing just how long residents of East Portland have been advocating for their fair share of services. The same with residents in North Portland who are facing the exact same experiences we do in East Portland. So having someone who understands, so when PDOT says, well, it's gonna cost way too much money to do the improvements in East Portland, and we would just spend a little bit of money in West Portland and have it beautified, having someone with a history of understanding those failed promises and those failed commitments over and over and over again, and someone who has the ability to count to three so that we can get the majority of the city council to vote to make sure that we're investing where we've lacked that commitment in the past. I think one of the biggest failures at the city of Portland right now is because of so many one-term mayors. There's not a city council vision of the city of Portland. So it just happens, anybody is operating in silos, and people don't live in silos. So we have to be able to work with other governments, we have to be able to work with the business community and neighborhood associations, and we have to make sure that we are people of our word, and we make sure that we invest where we have not invested in the past. Thank you, Felicia.
So my name is Felicia Williams, and election day is May 15th. So your ballots are going to be mailed out pretty soon. Voter pamphlets coming out pretty soon. Elections have consequences. We've already seen them with Washington, D.C. There are consequences. I've put my time in the trenches. I understand transportation. I understand the land use. I understand emergency preparedness, and I understand public safety. What I figured out is that we need leadership at City Council who knows how to balance compassion with common sense. That's why I'm running for City Council. I will balance compassion with common sense. That's why I'm asking for your vote on May 15th. My name is Felicia Williams. If you'd like more information, we have it upstairs. But please vote on May 15th. Thank you.
Thank you. Go ahead, Stuart.
I spent a lot of time in this community, especially when my affordable housing on a project on Holgate and 97th was being constructed. I have seen the lack of sidewalks and the lack of paved roads. I will bring to the Portland City Council decades of real-world private sector experience actually getting projects built and not just talking about them. Through neighborhood plans across the city, I have years of experience listening to communities and making good things happen. I've also worked with the city bureaus for my entire career, and we know we can do things better. I have talked about housing quite a bit, and people say, do you talk about anything else? And I say, rarely, because a safe, warm, and dry home is the foundation of a successful life. A successful city and should be our top priority. Our mayor called the housing crisis 3 years ago, and where are we today? We are in worse shape. There are good candidates in this race. but I am the only one with the experience and knowledge to move us beyond our homelessness and our affordable housing crisis.
Thank you. Andrea?
So again, my name is Andrea Vanderrama, and I'm running for Portland City Council Position 3. And I'm really excited to be in this race as someone representing the immigrant refugee community. I'm a first-generation Peruvian-American. I was born in the United States. My mom came as a political refugee at a time when the labor organizing that her and her family was doing cost them much more than their job. It cost them their home, and they had to flee. And so growing up with this social justice fight, with this conversation around workers' protections and a just society, is so integral to the work that I've done across Oregon. I am, again, serving on the David Douglas School Board in Outer East Portland, and to me it's so important to make sure that we are connecting the dots between our youth and the type of Portland that we want to leave, the future of Portland for those youth, for folks to be able to continue to live, grow, and thrive here. Again, before issues that I'm very much interested in thinking that I'm running to address as your next city commissioner include housing and homelessness, transportation, infrastructure, jobs, and community, public safety, and livability. You can find more information on my website, ballrama4pdx.com. Thank you.
Thank you. Loretta?
Any good question?
It's your closing statements.
Great. Thank you. I've spent a lifetime being a public servant. I am someone who will fight for the most vulnerable in our community. I have a track record of success and experience in education on the federal and the county level. I have relationships with people. I know how important it is to make sure that we help women in recovery, that we identify opportunities to improve the housing stock here. I know how important it is to make sure that public safety is an issue, because we do three things really well at the city. That's infrastructure, public safety, and making sure that commerce moves. And that makes sure that that means making sure that small business has access to capital, has access to people who have a good K-12 system, so that we can have qualified workers who can do the jobs to get those living wage jobs. That's how you deal with gentrification. That's how you deal with housing affordability, by making sure that you build a climate as an elected official so that folks can create jobs and they can have living wage jobs. That's what I'm going to be as a city commissioner. It's not going to be any different from what I was when I was a county commissioner, because I do have a track record that you can go back and look on. And I'd like to ask you all, vote for someone who's willing to fight. Someone who's willing to fight for, like, Wapato. You all probably saw that a couple days ago. We needed to make sure that we did our fiduciary responsibility and not give that property away. I was the lone voice saying to four other folks, we need to look at this, and we need to help our most vulnerable. Our most vulnerable, who 88 of us died on our streets last year. And we had a nice, pristine building that we could have put folks in. We could have relocated some of those services on site. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeanette.
Out of that, I spent 10 years as a staff assistant for the Multnomah County Chair. I also ran a nonprofit for 7 years, Oregon Action, working with the most vulnerable people in our community. I'm a three-term state legislator. I worked at the NAACP Portland branch from the extinction to being a vibrant civil rights champion in our community today. That's what I've done. That's what I will continue to do as your city council member. I am someone that gets accused of being the angry black woman because I actually have read the policy, and because I was a former state legislator, I understand the difference between developing policy and then having to implement the policy. And so I follow the money as well. I am proud to say to you that I have over 900 individual donors, people just like you. That's who's supporting my campaign. There aren't big money people that are pouring money into my campaign so that the status quo can continue. We don't need a status quo politician elected for the Portland City Council. What we need is fearless leadership that will be willing to ask the hard questions, demand real results, and
and will work across all lines to make sure that we are benefiting the people in the city of Portland. We only have a short period of time before we become the playground for the wealthy, and I will use every breath in my body to make sure that people at every income level have the opportunity to thrive in the city of Portland. I want your vote. Look at my record. I've earned your vote. Vote Joanne Hoxie for Portland City Council on May 15th. Thank you.
Thank you, Joanne. And thank you, candidates, for Portland City Council position number 3. Wait in your seats for just a moment. We're going to dismiss the candidates first. They can make their way to the elevator, and Grant, our timekeeper, will help them.
I'd just like to have everybody take a second to give